to start to notice some rainfall start late Saturday night. That rain will start, and then the temperatures will begin to cool as we head into early tomorrow morning. We'll have much more on that weekend outlook in just a little bit.
Riley, thank you. As we all brace for what the weekend holds, a lot of us are remembering the last time winter weather shut us down for days. It was back in 2014 when an ice storm followed snow. We topped off the week with an earthquake. As we hope for the best this time, Laura Warren shows us how crews are prepping for the worst just in case.
DOT trucks will be out on both sides of the river all night long, brining the roads to be ready for whatever comes our way.
Essentially salt water, that's what we're putting out on the roadways as a preventative precaution in case we see some snow and ice.
Crews are in overdrive, planning to be overly prepared after lessons learned from the 2014 ice storm.
Some refer to as the Snowmageddon. Obviously things didn't go as we wanted it to.
This time, prep started early.
But we'll be as ready as we can be by being proactive and putting out this brine. And we'll also transition over with some of our strike teams to do more of the plowing operations, if need be, with the snow.
And DOT, not the only crews on standby.
We have 1,400 employees for Columbia County, and any one of them will be ready in case we need to call them.
Now, all that's left to do is download the News 12 weather app and look for updates as we get closer.
You never know. You prepare for the worst, hope for the best.
Wise words there, and those DOT crews will be out all night long into tomorrow, so if you spot them out on the road, do give them room as they work to keep us all safe on the roads. For people who need a warm and safe place to stay overnight, May Park Community Center opening up this weekend, Saturday from 5 p.m. until Sunday at 9 in the morning, then again on Sunday from 5 until Monday morning at 9, and then on Monday from 5 till Tuesday at 9. Again, these are for overnight hours only. People need to be in the facility by 9 o'clock at night. Registration for that opens at 5 in the afternoon. May Park Community Center isn't the only resource for people in need. Our local Salvation Army is also getting ready to take in people during this cold snap. Maria Sellers, live for us in the newsroom to talk about what the Salvation Army is doing now to make sure our growing homeless population survives this storm.
The Salvation Army Center of Hope is already preparing for colder temperatures. Today, staff members began making sure they had beds and blankets ready and plenty of food as more people come in to use their services. As the temperature drops, the amount of people at the Salvation Army shelter goes up.
And normally, when the weather dips down, we'll see an influx.
Right now, the men's side of the shelter is almost full, and the women's side is about halfway there, and preparations have already started.
Our room policy says that if the temperature is 40 or below, that our guests will stay in. So we have been prepping for that, making sure that we have enough food, that we have enough blankets.
And making these preparations to keep the shelter open is essential for those who will need it.
Sleeping outside during this time, and with the rain coming as well, and maybe some ice, is not going to be a pleasant experience. So for us to be able to open up our doors and offer a warm lodging and hot meal is going to mean a world of difference to those that are coming in here.
And it wouldn't be possible without the public's support.
We just had a donation of blankets to come in just this afternoon in anticipation of the weather. So it's the generous and kind donations of the community that helps keep us going and open.
The shelter is open for anyone who needs a warm place to stay. The shelter will be open with normal hours. Check-in will begin at 4 p.m. and check-out will be 8 a.m. the next day. That's for both Saturday and Sunday. And Rhodes says the shelter may open early or check out late on both of those days, depending on weather conditions.
Maria Sellers in our newsroom tonight. Maria, thank you. New at 11, we're learning more about a double murder in Augusta late this afternoon. It happened here on Hammond Avenue, just off Peach Orchard Road. Two people killed, a third taken to AU Health for treatment. Richmond County deputies responded to the home right around 5:40 this evening. The coroner says both victims were shot at least one time. Those names will be released once the family members are notified. Investigators are calling this a domestic situation, and there's no information on whether deputies are looking for a suspect or how that injured person is doing. A family getting closer to justice, an arrest in connection to the shooting death of 8-year-old Aubrey Anthony. Today, Richmond County announcing that a warrant is issued for 21-year-old Antoine Redfield. He's already in custody at the Columbia County Detention Center and will be handed over to the Richmond County authorities to face charges here. Aubrey was killed while playing in her front yard outside her home at the Dogwood Terrace Apartments off Old Savannah Road less than a week ago. She was shot while she was looking at some horses someone brought by that neighborhood for the kids to see. Progress in the investigation, though, is giving the family some hope.
Oh, good. He feels good. It won't bring his baby back, but it's giving him some sense of closure, some sense of relief a little bit, but he feels good about it.
Richmond County Sheriff's Office says there could be more arrests as this investigation continues. Aiken County Sheriff's Office asking for your help to find a couple of wanted suspects. Deputies say 36-year-old April Watkins is wanted for 3 counts of unlawful conduct to a child. 39-year-old Daniel Watkins wanted for 10 counts of criminal sexual conduct with a minor. They say if you have any information, contact the Aiken County Sheriff's Office right there at the number on your screen, 803-648-6811. It's been a couple of months now since the infrastructure bill was signed into law. It means billions of dollars to replace and repair 15,000 bridges nationwide. In communities across the country, more than 45,000 bridges are in poor condition. The bill includes a new incentive to create more jobs by repairing some of those bridges.
We're going to have a lot of cones, a lot of orange cones out there for the next 5 years. But the cumulative impact, both from an economic standpoint and from a safety standpoint, is going to be terrific.
The Department of Transportation website has a look at how much money will be going to each state and how many bridges are in poor condition. So how much is heading to Georgia and South Carolina for the work? In the Peach State, $225 million to fix and repair more than 5,000 bridges in poor or fair condition. The Palmetto State said to get $274 million to improve around 5,000 bridges that are in bad shape. A service for victims of New York's deadliest fire will happen this Sunday, 1 week after the blaze. 17 people died, many of them children, in an apartment fire in the Bronx. Private funerals started yesterday for 2 of those victims, and community leaders have been working to make plans for those remaining victims. There are multiple lawsuits against the owners of the buildings seeking billions of dollars in damages. One of the largest student loan servers in the country just reaching a more than $1.5 billion settlement. Navient will be paying more than 36 states. The lawsuit says the loan management company steered borrowers further into debt through forbearance practices, which allow borrowers to temporarily postpone repayment while still being charged interest on those loans. We're back to keeping track of our local school district's COVID cases. Today, Richmond County reporting 151 positive students, just under 70 positive staff members. Columbia County much higher, almost 700 students positive and 149 staff members. Richmond County has been sending students home lately due to COVID cases there, and that seems to be paying off in Richmond County. Omicron staffing shortages, winter weather. We're taking a look at how all are affecting your grocery shopping. Riley?
Richard, we still have a first alert in of Monday later in the day.
Riley, thanks. Milk, bread, meat, other basic goods wiped clean from many grocery store shelves. Isabel Rosales reports on the challenges of the industry from coronavirus to transportation problems.
Sleet, ice, and heavy snow. Another major winter storm set to slam into much of the eastern U.S. Raising alarms, it may pile on more setbacks for grocers. In the produce business for 25 years, Alfredo Larios can't find produce.
It's hard right now. I never seen this happen. This is new to us.
It's his business, keeping grocery stores and restaurants stocked.
We feel terrible because we don't know what the future will gonna happen. We're talking about the problem.
Zachkin Oskul is a supply chain expert. He insists while there is enough food, it's not all getting to stores. The Omicron variant delivering a devastating blow to an already stretched thin workforce.
People are either quarantining or they are basically testing positive for this.
And Americans are changing up how they eat.
Some folks are just deciding to eat more at home.
And dangerous weather is crippling major travel routes. Last week, a backup on I-95 left truck drivers stranded for almost a whole day.
I think I-95 being shut down for 20 hours is pretty bad.
Jose Sandoval has been trucking goods for a decade.
I start at 4 in the morning, I go home at 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock because I still not finish my route.
He sees the shortage of drivers like him as dire.
That's one thing that we need people to work, but they don't want to work.
weather, we may see more disruptions over the coming weekend, but shoppers should see some relief, they say, by the spring. We have to hang on. People started looking for things to do when the pandemic locked us all down, and one teenager has kept his